Discovering Alabama is a production of the Alabama Museum of Natural History.
As a child, I often wondered, does the breeze wave the trees, or does the waving of the trees create the breeze? Pristine water shimmering across the forest floor. Is this where precious stones are polished? Multifarious light glistening among the arboreal. Is this where the rainbow gets its color? Red light running lightly below the branches. Can it really give birth to new life?
Hi, I'm Doug Phillips. Here in an Alabama enchanted forest, it's kind of fun to harken back to those childhood days of mystery and wonder. Now that I'm, well, a little older, I've learned that the magic is real.
The waving trees clean the breeze, refreshing the air for you and me to breathe. Entire watersheds are nourished as pristine waters emerge from forests for you and me to drink. Colors of the rainbow can be found glistening in an autumn sun. And even that which we once thought only threatening can be seen in a whole new light.
Join me for a walk in the woods. We'll enjoy Alabama's enchanted forests. And we'll explore the ecological and economic wonders of these arboreal realms.
We'll investigate the science behind the magic. We'll probe misconceptions about the timberlands. And we'll meet the men and women, the private landowners and their consulting foresters who keep the forest flourishing for you and me. This program is about a land unknown to many people, a land that in many ways has maintained its native natural wonders, a place of bountiful backcountry, forests, streams, and wildlife more diverse than can be found in much of the inhabited world. Come along with me as we explore the wild wonders of this land. Come along as we discover Alabama.
Welcome to Discovering Alabama, and welcome to the Enchanted Forest. By the latest tallies, roughly 70% of all of Alabama is covered in forest land. Our state is indeed a grand sylvan realm.
From above, it's easy to mix metaphors and think of Alabama as adrift in a sea of forests. Thank you.
23 million acres of timberlands in Alabama. 23 million acres, and of that staggering amount, the great majority is owned by private, non-industrial landowners.
In the more than 30-year history of discovering Alabama, we've spent a lot of time in Alabama forests.
We've done a number of shows, for example, about our national forests, our state parks, and other public lands. But public lands are just a small part, only about 5% of Alabama lands.
By far, the largest portion of Alabama's grand sylvan realm is privately owned, some in corporate ownership, and the great majority owned by individual Alabamians and their families. The caring stewardship practiced by private forest land owners is essential to the continuing abundance of Alabama's forest heritage.
The resource, the quality of the resource, and the amount of the resource is extremely important to everybody in Alabama. We are certainly happy to have the rockets and the airplanes and the automobiles and everything else that is so important to our people and our economy of our state, but we need to have that awareness that agriculture and forestry and related businesses are still the backbone of Alabama's economy and our environment.
The private forest land in Alabama is far greater than most people think. More than 70% of the forests that we have in Alabama are owned by the non-industrial private landowner. Timber industry owns less than 17%. So the primary manager of our forests are people like you and me.
Yeah, well, I think it's very important for Alabama because we only have a small percentage of our forests that are public forests, that are national forests or in some other type of public holding. And yet forestry is so important to the state of Alabama. So I think it's important economically because most of our logging and forest industry is based on private land as opposed to forest holding. I think it's also important for recreational purposes and for species richness of the state, which is one of the things we really value very much because we have such high species richness. A great deal of the stewardship of forests comes through private owners. And I think in Alabama, there's been some great successes with private owners who really take that very seriously.
The backbone of our economy and our environment. There was a time not so long ago when some folks saw economic values and ecological values as being in conflict with one another. Nowadays, we recognize that our forest values are diverse.
One of the great gifts that we have in Alabama is the diversity across the board. Among trees, we're one of the most diverse states in the nation. And that's pretty rare across most of the country to have that diversity available. Some of these trees are fantastic to keep for economic reasons, for sawtimber, for pulpwood, for poles. Some of them are just great for wildlife benefits because of the fruit or the nuts that they produce, and other for aesthetics.
It looks like it's big enough to be cut.
That one right here?
Yeah. And I hear they leave.
I have seen a great deal of change. Back in the day when I was in forestry school, a lot of the forest management was encouraged and driven by the need for pine pulpwood. There's been a gradual but very drastic change. Many landowners are going to restoration projects.
With something in the neighborhood of almost 200 different native tree species in Alabama, opportunity abounds for forest landowners.
Typically, management incorporates the objectives that a landowner would have for their land. If, for example, they're more concerned or primarily concerned with maximum timber income. Or they're concerned primarily with recreation. Or they're concerned with aesthetics. You can devise a plan for them that will help them accomplish their objectives. Now, management can be a whole wide range of things, from prescribed burning to road construction and maintenance to thinning and harvesting timber and regeneration of that timber. For the most part, you'll find many private non-industrial landowners are interested in a combination of objectives. But you really think about it, they all go hand in hand. You can accomplish multiple objectives by setting a program for them based on timber management, recreation, or aesthetics, and still accommodate various other objectives.
You can make recommendations based on landowner goals, but you also have to understand the local ecology, and you can't lose sight of that. Every decision that's made should be driven by landowner goals and site conditions, and supported with good science.
Some might say managing the forest for certain goals seems incongruous. They might think, well, the forests were here long before we humans, so if we just left the forest alone, wouldn't nature manage the forest? Well, maybe, but we humans have a habit of not leaving the forest alone.
This is as good an example.
For instance, we could do a whole show on the human-introduced invasive species that threaten our native forests.
Very, very difficult. Here are the berries from last year. Birds eat them thinking that they're getting a bunch for it. Kogan grass, which is what this grass is, to be able to control this, there are virtually no opportunity for us to control it.
Come to think of it, we have done a whole show on the alien invaders threatening our homeland. The biggest threats to our forests, though, may not be from faraway places. They may be right up the road.
Urbanization is another big threat. We have more and more people that are living in urban areas, and less connection with rural Alabama, rural America, and an understanding that somebody has got to get their hands dirty, somebody has got to be willing to tend that forest.
Fewer and fewer Alabamians are getting their hands dirty. Fewer and fewer Americans are getting their hands dirty. And this can lead to misconceptions about forest land ownership.
One of the more common misconceptions is that all private forest owners are wealthy.
David, you have three brothers and two sisters, and y'all own this property jointly?
That's right. We've kind of tried to hold on to it, and it goes back, I guess, this property, when I was growing up, was owned by my dad and his four sisters, and Dad worked hard to get us, you know, to get this to where it is so we could own it. My five siblings and everything, we was able to. So we've been very fortunate and under his hard work, you know, to get this place and what we have right now. So we've been waiting for this. Now this timber is probably 30 years old and it's just now starting to get some value. So it's been a process for us to get it back to this point. And so that's where we brought you in to try to help us manage that part of it. And maybe we can start here in the very near future, start getting some income back off of it and help all the family members some, because everybody, you know, could sure use a little bit of help.
When you look at the fact that your income is very sporadic, maybe every 10 years will you do a cut in a stand like this. And with that, every year you have your annual taxes and you have to pay that on an annual basis, and you don't get income on an annual basis.
That's right. That's exactly right. We're the consummate example of being land rich, I guess, and money poor.
The misconception that all private forest land owners are somehow wealthy land barons might not seem like a big deal, but such fiction can lead to real-world consequences.
That's an accurate statement, land rich and dollar poor, because the asset has a tremendous value. But tax policy, inheritance taxes, and property taxes, ad valorem taxes, we see the family having to sell part of the land or overcut timber more intensively than they would like to, or that would make sense from a purely timber management standpoint and wildlife management standpoint, just to be able to pay the taxes.
Well, probably not a lot of people really understand is that a lot of that tax does not come back to the landowner. It goes out to different levels, to a local and a state level, which the landowner does not see a lot of return from that money as well. So it is a cost for them.
This is not just a play place for us. It's an obligation, and that we pay taxes. I don't care what they say about Alabama being the lowest tax rate in the nation, but we pay substantial taxes.
Stand right.
On just on the, this, just because it's here.
Minimum, you're okay, because that's where more of your
it is an obligation for us to take care of it. And I think most city people think we're just playing at it.
The green is the pine, of course. Right. And this discolored, it makes everything look clean. It makes everything.
The benefit of having a lower tax here in Alabama is that it allows for that piece of property to stay in what it's meant to stay in, and that's timberland. Timberland provides an awesome opportunity for not just that family who owns that piece of property, but for everybody else, because it does provide an avenue for clean air, for clean water, as well as the wildlife value that comes with all of that. That value benefits everybody. It benefits the whole state.
Tax policy can and probably will be debated till the end of time. And like any debate, there are two sides, probably more, with the complicated issues of property tax.
Critics will point out that Alabama forest land taxes are at the lower end of the scale when compared to other states. On the flip side, moderate taxes are a major reason so many Alabama families can continue to own and care for the land. Rising land taxes, typical in many states, are a leading cause of fragmentation and loss of forests, as owners are forced to divide their lands or fall prey to commercial development.
I don't think we're ever going to have a point where we've got to go in and say, we've got too much land protected, and we've got to turn some of this over to commercial use. But as it is, over two-thirds of the land in Alabama is privately owned. And that's outside of federal protection, outside of state protection. And it's in the hands of those landowners as to what is done with that land.
Public lands are certainly important, and we need to protect what we have on any parks, any wildlife refuges, any kind of protected habitats at state level, federal level, county level even. Yeah, we have to keep that. But these animals are distributed. Some of them are very isolated populations. There might be one or two populations on the public lands and 50 on the private lands. We need to be protecting those too.
It's so important. So, you know, we're doing work all over the state, maybe in protected areas, maybe in parks, national forests, state lands. But it's really important to cultivate these relationships with private landowners that have maybe an important habitat for maintaining the connections and the ecosystem for different species in Alabama. So that is extremely important, and to have them understanding some of the science that we're doing and developing that partnership.
We're very fortunate in Alabama that most of our landowners understand the conservation value of the land, and many of them have them in Treasure Forest Association or Forest Owner Associations, and they have read books like, you know, Aldo Leopold's Sand County Almanac, or they've been to an environmental education program, and they realize the connections between the habitat and the health of not only the flora and fauna, but of the people that live near those properties.
Private landowners may not all be rich, but they all do have responsibilities. And fortunately for you and me, so many Alabama landowners take their responsibilities very seriously.
I would like to see some sort of mechanism in place to educate people on the value of rural timberland, on the value of forests, on the value of maintaining the forest.
We're 80 miles south of Birmingham. What goes on here, believe it or not, affects air quality up the river in Birmingham. At this time, I'm educating my kids, let the trees mature. It's good for the environment. You clear cut, you replant. Everything you take off the land, you put back on it.
A good management of forest really protects the environment in many ways, is what we're talking about. There's a direct benefit then to good stewardship of our forests. And so we're referring to that when we talk about the ecological services. And it's really a relationship between forests and the Earth's surface and hydrologic processes that we have. So there's a direct relationship then between forest health and Earth's surface processes that are very important. And we're referring to this as ecological services.
private lands help to filter the pollution out of the atmosphere, provides oxygen for you to breathe. They cool the planet, making life more pleasant for you there. The soil and the leaf litter filters the water as it comes down, flows to the creeks where it can be pulled up and used for drinking water. They provide jobs.
The air cleaning, water purifying, job creating nature of our forests is today in the hands of human forest owners.
Sustaining the ecological services and economic services given us by Alabama forests requires ongoing human care.
And sometimes caring for the forest takes place outside the forest.
I do a lot of the analytical work that supports all of our forest management that we do, from growing trees on computer to doing discounted cash flow analysis. Most of us got into forestry because we love the outdoors and we wanted to spend outdoors, but as you start to get more knowledgeable and deal with bigger and bigger things, you end up sitting in front of a computer a lot more than you anticipated. And in fact, the skill sets and the knowledge that a forester has to have are some of the higher level sciences and math.
Hey, Rick, did you have a chance to look at the output?
Yes, and it's the numbers, the acres are right, but we still got that variance in there, and I'm not really sure what it is. I'm going to have to drill down, but the good thing is the negative ones, negative twos, and zeros are right, so that's good.
Okay, well, if we need to rerun that, you know, we can
we might have to rerun it under.
Science is one of those things that you get into it and there's discovered that you know just this much, and then you open it up and you realize there's just even that much more to know. And at that point is also an intuitive kind of thing that goes on, where the people that have spent a lot of time in the woods, who are observant, who have seen things, who have been around, like the Keevil Larsons of the world and stuff, that's where more of the art comes in.
Many, myself included, see the forest as a work of art. Layers of color, subtleties of light, drama in action, and a medley of scents and sounds come together to celebrate creation. Thank you.
They can teach you certain things in school. They can teach you the cost of carrying a plantation over several years, and that's a science. The art is learning how your management tools interact with an infinite variety of forests that are out there, and there's no way to teach someone how to exactly manage a mature longleaf forest on a Lakeland sand in the panhandle of Florida versus on a really good Orangeburg soil in lower Alabama, and with all the different competing trees and the different fire regimes and different herbicides, a lot of it has to do with simply getting the experience under your belt.
These days, science and technology are informing our knowledge of forests, from the microbes that nurture the soils to the sunlight that trickles through the treetops.
When it comes to harmonizing information and artistry, it still takes people willing to get their hands dirty.
It's critical for us, for the success of this, to have a consulting forester. Phillip's an accountant, I'm a teacher. We don't know how to grow trees. And if we didn't have somebody like that, it would not look anything like it does. It is the way it is today because of Alex and because of the other people that have helped us. You know, we don't have what I call a cookie cutter forest because for us, the aesthetics is very important.
We have to have a professional forester. I'm not a professional forester. I'm barely an amateur forester. And this place does take a lot of effort to look after. We rely on our forester an awful lot, stay in touch with him often, and sit down with him several times a year and go over what the plans will be for the next year, the next 3 years, the next 5 years. What does it look like? Without that, we couldn't do the job with respect to the timber.
Here in the state of Alabama, there is a licensing board, the Board of Registration for Foresters. They have to have today 2 years of experience before they can sit for the exam and then be a licensed forester within the state. What consultants typically do are represent private landowners.
Find a lot of those around here. There's a couple of, red oak there. Actually, there's a white oak too.
There's a white oak? Yeah, okay.
That's a white oak, which you'll find a lot of those around here.
Yeah, right.
There's a cherry tree.
Yeah.
I know there's one right there, that split one right over there. It looks like that may be just a regular water oak.
A forestry consultant is a person who works for the non-industrial private landowner to work just for that person and not be an advocate for the timber industry. Of course, we work with the timber industry. We sell our products to them. But our interest is making sure that the landowner is protected in all of the things that he does in his forest.
As a consulting forester, we have to know a little bit about everything. It doesn't mean we have to know everything, but we got to know who to go to be able to help us bridge that gap to where we can help that landowner, because that's where our interest lies, is helping them to achieve whatever goal that they have.
It has evolved a whole lot where it's not just managing, it's counseling. A lot of times we're helping families figure out how can they, there's five of them and they got so many acres, and do you want to divide it, do you want to sell it, do you want to manage it, keep it together? And they need that sort of advice.
You know, it doesn't need to have a thinning done right mm-hmm. now, but it could. This in the back is where your pine plantation is. And we didn't look at it, but he showed me the road coming in on the other side. Mm-hmm. So I've already looked at it.
To call yourself a forester in the state of Alabama, you have to be registered as forester. And that requires you to go to at least a four-year degree, a bachelor's in science of forestry management, or you could possibly get a master's degree. So if you're going to call yourself a forester and then advertise your services as a professor, in that profession in Alabama, you have to be a registered forester, and you have to take the registered forester's exam and pass it. And it is one of the more difficult. I've heard it has about a 50% fail rate, and this is after you've gotten your degree and had several years of experience in the field. So it's a very rigorous test here in the state of Alabama.
The very nature of Alabama is a rigorous test of the knowledge and skills of consulting foresters in our state. Challenges abound, from mountains of hardwoods to coastal plain pine. It's enough to make you wonder, is there a time when even a consulting forester needs a consulting forester?
You know, strange enough that you asked that question. My wife and I, we own some property in North Alabama, and things are different up there in markets and species and access and so forth. And I actually consult with a fellow that works up there to advise me on what are the possibilities of managing that land up there.
All the ground underneath here that is going to spoil your view.
The sweet gum and all this.
Yeah, well, up here to make a viable sale, do you think?
Oh, yeah. Yes, definitely. There's enough
sale. Well, that's good to know.
Just in terms of our thinking down south where I work, you know, we burn properties every 2-4 year cycle under the pine trees. So would that have any place up here? You know, we got a little pine stand down there or up in this hardwood.
We can use fire in the hardwood up here as long as we keep it low and cool, and that can control some of these weed species that you've got growing in here. And I'd like to see something done to control some of these weed species. Alex, in terms of the forest health, one thing I have not seen is oak regeneration. The shade that's on the ground and the competition from these other trees is just wiping out your oak regeneration. We talked about fire. That can encourage oak regeneration.
Regeneration, there's a word packed with meaning for consulting foresters and for forest land owners. Its meaning can be literal.
Well, Hurricane Ivan was followed by Hurricane Dennis. And what Ivan started 1 year, Dennis finished the next year. But it was Alex who said, this is gonna be our long range plan. And we followed what he said. You know, with a consulting forester, it's a two-way street. They have to listen to you to know what your goals are, but when you need their expertise, you have to listen to them because they have the ability to know. And here we are now, and you can't tell there was a hurricane.
As literal as the regeneration of the forest can be, there's that figurative sense of the word that has equally powerful meaning.
So what kind of snake is he?
Some of the greatest experiences that students can have are those hands-on experiences outside those four walls of the classroom and to experience the real world. And we find that a lot of our private landowners within our county, and we are blessed with so many very good ones that allow us to come onto their property, whether it be to go into their creek and do a little bit of water sampling, whether it be to walk through the woods and just talk about the benefits of forestry and the interconnectedness of wildlife and forestry. And a lot of our landowners are just freely offering their resources to us, resources that we don't have available to us at a public school. A lot of times you have to start within those four walls of a classroom, and you have to give them the background and the knowledge that they need to be able to understand what they're going to see and experience when they go outside. And that's along the lines of all the courses of study and the standards, the science standards, the math standards, and all that. We must teach those. That is something that we have to do. But we extend that into something that will make sense to them, that they will forever remember. And we're really blessed here in Alabama to have private landowners who allow school groups and other organizations to come onto their properties to experience so much of the natural resources that we have available to us. To be able to instill the love of the great outdoors and to instill the love of the land in a child is probably the greatest thing we can ever do. And we've all been blessed as educators to be able to do that.
Did you do that? That's cool, wasn't it? You know, when I was a kid, we used to do that. We sure did.
You know, we say, oh, this is my land. It's not really my land, it's God's land. We're simply blessed to be the generational steward of it for this time period. But you want to pass it to the next generation. They're the next keepers of the forest. And we want this property to be open where it can teach others. That's the only way you're ever going to pass the legacy on and pass the knowledge on.
2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20.
A few years ago, my grandmother purchased about 100 cypress sprigs
from Ernie,
from Mr. Ernie, our forester, and she gave each grandchild, there are four of us, she gave each of us 25 cypress trees, and she said, go out at the farm, wherever you want to plant it, and plant all 25 trees, and she gave us each shovels. That was our Christmas present. We got a shovel. Me and my brother planted two just down this road next to an artesian well that's free-flowing.
When Miss Robinson called me and asked me for these seedlings, I wasn't sure exactly what she had in mind, and then she told me that she was going to put y'all to work, so I got a real chuckle out of that. So, but y'all did a good job picking the right spot.
You know, I've talked with folks really all across the country. Been able to meet them, talk to them, and really to understand what their objectives are, because if you can develop a good relationship with a landowner and do them the best job possible, gives me a joy and a satisfaction as well to be able to come back 15 years or 20 years and work on that same site that you did, you know, years ago.
I think the pieces of property and families we've worked with for the longest period of time, and seeing the property develop and the landowners' needs be met, that's a big satisfaction. It really is. We had some clients that we still have a client that we started work on 1950 something 53 or so. Whew, that's a long time, and we've been taking care of that for those owners all that period. And oh, the improvement in the property.
We do know that what we're doing today is many years down the road, and there is clearly we have a real sense of responsibility to that, and we feel that. Our profession feels that deeply.
You know,
We have just a very small window in time that we're here doing this. So whatever we leave behind for the future, I think, is the measure for success. And it's just a very rewarding career, and I'm just totally blessed working with private landowners. It's just a satisfaction beyond measure, being able to accomplish a goal for a landowner that they've been wanting to do for a long time, or just being part of that process.
But I thought about doing some thinning.
I love being a forester. That it's just pleasant out here. It's an environment that brings you back and makes you realize who you are, where you are, what your relationship to the earth is. Our souls can be regenerated, if you want to say it that way.
There are some solid pragmatic values to our forest. They freshen our air, they cleanse our water, they bolster our economy.
All good reasons to appreciate the private landowners and consulting foresters who keep the forest flourishing. Our Alabama forests, though, transcend the practical.
These enchanting realms inspire a freshening, a cleansing, a bolstering of the spirit.
For forest landowners who might be interested in joining various helpful organizations, several are available. Likewise, there is website information available for contacting a qualified consulting forester in your area. Thank you.
Discovering Alabama is produced in partnership with the University of Alabama College of Continuing Studies. Discovering Alabama is produced in partnership with Alabama Public Television. Discovering Alabama is a production of the Alabama Museum of Natural History. This program is supported by grants from the Solon and Martha Dixon Foundation. The Alabama Wildlife Federation, working for wildlife since 1935. And the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute at the University of Alabama, providing educational and social opportunities for adults.